research in agriculture. Then came medicine and engineering, so in health and in manufacturing. So statistics has always been thought of as a tool which helps us do things better in the field of biology, agriculture, health, manufacturing. And people did not think of statistics as something that can be related to arts. So today's presentation is to break that myth and how statistics can, up to a point, there is no hope that a statistician can create on his computer a Picasso, but there are some things that you can do with statistics, which is what I will illustrate. Milind, your time is on? Very good. Okay. So first we will take literature, then we will go to movies. Okay. So in literature, the question is, why would you bother about statistical tools? And the answer is that one specific issue in statistics, in literature, is authorship disputes. You have a piece of writing, you don't know who wrote it, and statistics has been used as a tool for doing this. And I, last 2 months, I have been telling everybody there is a series of detective stories on Zee Cafe. The name of the series is Numbers, and they try to discover who the criminal is using statistics. So I would invite you to view some of those. Thank you. Yeah. So the most famous example is from American history, and these documents are called Federalist Papers. These were essays written during the freedom struggle of United States, and the authors were many: Hamilton, Jefferson, Madison, Jay, and so on. This is, we are talking about 1787. And there were many, there some essays were signed and some essays were unsigned, and historians were keen to know who wrote those essays. And those essays were a propaganda piece of work to seek support for ratification of the new American Constitution. And then two statisticians, Frederick Mosteller and what is his first name, so and so Wallace, wrote a book in 1964. Titled Inference and Disputed Authorship. And this was the first pleasant surprise of my studentship in USA. My teacher gave me a job of doing things in the library, and I saw this book. I had never seen it in India. It was 5 or 6 years old book, and it really caught my imagination. So what did they want to do? They wanted to decide, take an essay and decide which of these fellows is the most probable author of that essay. So you need some numbers, okay? So should we have some numerical measures? And numerical measuring and analysis in literature is called stylometry. Stylometry. And if you Google the word stylometry, you can get a lot of interesting references. So what are the numerical characters? Word length, number of letters in a word. Sentence length, number of words in a sentence. Are these typical of an author? So some people write, you know, in older Marathi, in plays, heroes talked in very long sentences, and they wanted to sound very impressive. In modern literature, that is absolutely gone. Okay, so maybe there is something that is typical of an author. How do we compare? So they say that the most common word length for Shakespeare was 4-letter words. Anyway, you can compare the distribution of word lengths for different authors, or distribution of sentence length. And if one author is characterized by one distribution, another author is characterized by another distribution, then maybe you can take an essay. This is all very nice as a theory, but it involves the assumption that the variable used has the same form of distribution for all authors, but each author has a unique parameter value. They are all normal, but he has a smaller mean, that has a larger mean. This is the assumption. So what do you do? And this is standard in computer science also. You take known material, material with known authorship, for training your programs, okay? And then you decide on a criterion and use that criterion. Let us say change in the mean word length or something like that. To decide the author of a disputed item. So you count the mean of the disputed paper, and then if the mean is very large, then probably the author who uses long words is the author of it. Very simple idea. Are these decisions error-free? Absolutely not. None of the statistical decisions are error-free. Yesterday we talked about false positives and false negatives. This is not failure of that experimenter. I want you to understand this. Some mistakes happen because the experimenter is incompetent. Some mistakes happen because the experimenter actually made a physical mistake. Some errors happen because the supplier gave a contaminated reagent. Those are not the errors we are talking about. In statistics, we only talk about errors which remain after eliminating all these things. Okay. So what do? We take two essays of the same author, apply our tool. Is the tool doing a good job? Then we have confidence in that tool. Will our method conclude that author is the same, etc.? So these are the kinds of things we do. What kind of distributions are involved? Typically log normal, that means whatever you measure, take logarithm of it and that follows a normal distribution. Unfortunately, all this nice theory, parameters are not consistent from one essay of the author to another essay of the same author. So this is not very useful. It's an idea, not very useful. So the other idea is use word frequency. How frequently does an author use a particular word? But this word cannot be anything. If I am talking about statistics, inevitably my lecture will involve the word statistics a lot. That's not because of me, that's because of the topic. Anybody talking about statistics presumably will talk about statistics, right? So there are some contextual words. They have to be eliminated. They do not signify style of the author. Take non-contextual word. If I use abuse words, that's me. Okay. And different in Kokan, one kind of abuse is used. In Kolhapur, another kind of abuse is used. So that is characteristic. So use context-free words. Okay, that is the one message. So you start with the notion how frequently this word is used, generally. Then you use data on that author and correct this. That becomes the criterion for that individual author. So that is the idea. Alright, so some words are contextual, so we cannot use them. Function words, linking words. I am going to. So to is a link word. So I use it. Some people will use the a lot. Some people will use a lot, etc. Okay. Punctuation marks. Some people, when they write a lot of commas, others write semicolons, etc. But counting is very difficult physically. I started work on this. I finished my PhD in 72. I saw this thing first in 1970 and I made up my mind. I am going to mimic these fellows sometime in my life. But counting the words is extremely painful. And basically, I am a very lazy fellow. So who will do it? So I waited until I became senior enough so I have an assistant. That is when he and I were together. But he was not the one. There were a couple of other people in the lab. And I said, you don't have work, then do this work. Like yesterday, Professor Kaya was saying, he was a clerk in the state government. And their superintendent would say, your work is finished, now study for your BA. So that's what I did. And I got some things counted. This is long before the computers became. So you have to have computer-based methods. Anyway, so in case of Hamilton and Madison, what these fellows did was they selected 30 words and for each word they counted the rate of occurrence for Hamilton or Madison and then take a product of ratios of different words. So criterion, if the ratio is 1, then both authors are equally likely. If ratio is very high, then Hamilton is more likely. If ratio is very low, then Madison is very likely. This was the simple idea. And they worked for all papers with known authorship and they found that the criterion seems to work well. So they calculated the criteria for disputed authorships and values came out to be very small. And therefore they said that Madison is more likely. When I read this, you know, I have great interest in history and I had never thought that my training in statistics can be used in history. So when I read this, I was thrilled. I went to my supervisor who had given me that job and I said, you know, boss, there is this book and they say that Madison is the more likely author. So he was very quiet. This is what happens with a young boy and a old white-haired or bald-headed supervisor. Sit down. He said, it all depends upon who is ruling the country. If Democrats are ruling the country, statisticians give one decision. And if Republicans are ruling the country... See, Hamilton was one of the most senior Republican leaders. So I said, what a cynical prof I have got, you know. So I'm going to use this in India, I said, sometime. And I came back and I had the assistance and I had the problem. See, one difficulty in applied statistics is getting the right kind of problem. So in those days I found that historians were arguing, and one of the historians was connected with somebody who is here. So where is Palshikar? He has run away, so we have to... Where is Palshikar? So let us see all the unpleasant things while he is not here. But his father is a great scholar. I have a great regard for him. I treat him, consider him my guru. He wrote an essay in 1977 in one of the Diwali issues, arguing about some unsigned editorials in Kesari, and said, I think Agarkar wrote these. Then another historian wrote another essay and said, who is this Palshikar? Silly fellow. Tilak wrote this. So now I had a problem to solve, right? And I had evidence that historians cannot resolve it. So I got my assistants to work on this. This is 19th century, late 19th century. They were friends and working together. They were both editors of Kesari. But then they fought about whether social reform should come first or political reform should come first. And then Agarkar started his own newspaper, which died in course of time. Kesari is still alive. It has lost its ideology, but physically it is still alive. So there were unsigned editorials of Kesari, which historians were debating about. Remember, an applied, this is my message for all the statisticians here. If you take up a problem which has no recognition in another field, then people will laugh at you. The biologists or the educationists or the economists must claim that this is a problem. Only then statisticians can make a worthwhile attempt at solving them. Okay? So in this case, my first step was, two historians are contesting. One says Tilak is the author, other says Agarkar is the author. Bang! So here I have a position where I can resolve this dispute. This step is absolutely essential, and this is a step where you cannot do much. It is the others who have to state this is a problem which we cannot solve. So one condition we had for accepting people into this workshop is they must have attempted a problem and reached a stage where they think they cannot resolve that problem. That's the raw material for applied statistics. Okay? Alright. So who wrote these? And historians have different opinions. I did not give the names, but one was Palshikar and other I forget. Maybe Yadi Phdke. Yes. So we tried word length distribution, sentence length distribution. They had log normal distribution, but they don't remain consistent even for the same author. Forget about characterizing different authors. So some peculiar word usage seemed more useful, and some punctuation marks were peculiar. And I must confess that I have been very lazy. This was, 30 years ago, and now I am very disorganized. I could not find my papers. I could not recall what those words and what those punctuation marks were that we used. But we did the calculations and found that Agarkar was the more likely author of these papers. And we went to a journal in Deccan College, and they were rather surprised that people who have no connection with literature and so on, statisticians, are coming, and they published it simply for the novelty of it. They said, oh, we can use these methods also. And then the great day came when my colleague Dr. Kunte walked into my office and said, have you seen the second edition of Master and Wallace's paper, book? I said, no, why? He said, because they have quoted at length your paper. They are very pleasantly surprised that their techniques have been used in a faraway place in a remote language called Marathi. So that is about literature. How many minutes so far? How much time did I consume? Oh, great. So I can talk a lot about cinema. Oh, I want to tell all the statisticians that there are two wonderful magazines. One is named Chance and the other is named Significant. Significant is a recent one. It is published jointly by the American Statistical Association and Royal Statistical Society. And for some strange reason, I keep receiving issues of Significance without paying, which makes me very, very happy. But these are very wonderful. Huh? Ah, so maybe that's why I am so lucky. So you should, you know, seek. Ah, great. Wiley, go to the Wiley website and perhaps you can download. Great. So this is a very nice magazine you should read. And there was an article on study of cinema. So I said, wow, I have never used statistics for study of cinema. I enjoy watching movies. But this stuff is very raw. It is not mine. I don't have any feel for what I'm going to tell you. So I'll tell you briefly and move on because I don't know what they're talking about. They are talking about identifying style of a director based on length of a shot. Okay, the random variable is length of a shot. What is a shot? You start a camera, action, and then cut. That's a shot. And you measure the length in seconds. Okay. And some people take long shots and etc. I don't understand any of this. So. But there is a wonderful website. www. You know, earlier, remember the name word was stylometry? Now these guys are using another word, cinemetrics. www.cinemetrics.lv, I guess. Or I don't know, IV. And this website has tons of data. It has tons of papers. And discussion boards, all those mathematical cinematographers are discussing. Yeah, I was astounded. This says, you know, we all need introstat, isn't it? Here is one place where you can get very nicely explained introstat. Cinema fellows are talking about this. All this you can see on that website. So the random variable, when I interview statisticians for a job, one very typical question is, do you know the difference between math and stat? And surprisingly, a large number of people, they lose their wicket. And my teacher RK used to ask this question. So quite secretly once told me the right answer. So the right answer is that mathematics also involves variables, but statistics involves random variables. Okay, that's the only difference. All right. So the variable is short length. And this is like word length and sentence length. And if you take log, then you have a log normal distribution. And then short type, a close-up medium. I don't understand any of this. Medium short, long short, very long short. And proportions of different short types. This is another way. So some directors are, their pet shot is a close-up. And for some directors, it's a long shot, etc. So you can compare these proportions and say that this film is of this type, etc. Oops. Alright. So the measurements are proportions of different shot types. And you can compare different films of the same director, compare different directors. But here, short length data. So I talked about log normal distribution. Here is an example. On the x-axis, it is class. This is a picture. I have not generated this graph. I just borrowed it from that website. So class intervals are in seconds. But I was amazed by this. This is a real life data set, a beautiful log normal distribution. So enough about that. Enough about stuff that I don't understand. And let's talk about stuff that I do understand. And this time it is Hindi movies, the most favorite topic of me and most of my listeners. So when I go to any popular lecture in a college, if I talk about movies, so my wife said, I will tell you a beginning sentence always, and it clicks. Huh? So she said, you have to tell the audience, you see, this morning when my wife said, where are you going today? How are you going to waste your time today? So I'm going to go and talk to these students in this college. She said, what do you have to tell these young people, you baldy old man? So I said, that is true. That I am a baldy old man. How do I can't fix that situation. She said, well, talk about something that they like. So I said, what do they like? She said, they will like discussions about current heroines. But I don't know the current heroines. So okay, I will tell you names. And I endlessly confused between Kareena Kapoor and Katrina Kaif. So, she said, talk about movies, then audience will quiet down, then you tell your nonsense about statistics and all this. So I use that formula wherever I go. Let us talk about Hindi movies. Today, I will only talk about Hindi movies. No, no. Hindi movies is one of the largest movie making industries in the world. What I say is all borrowed from this man. And you should write this name down. He is an IIM MBA. And he has his website, I think. And he writes analysis of Hindi movies. So everything I'm going to show is 100% borrowing from Sandeep Khurana. And these are the web addresses in case you cannot find it, and presumably you can borrow from here. I must tell you about that address, moneylife.in. Moneylife is a magazine, and if you are at all, so there should be some people in economics and commerce here, you should read Moneylife, because it's a public service organization, and the head of that organization is a lady named Sucheta Dalal. And you should do Google this name. She is an amazing journalist. I have been reading Sucheta Dalal's columns in Indian Express for many years. Now she has stopped, and now she runs her own magazine. And what is the topic? Money. That means capital markets, shares, companies, fixed deposits, banks, this and that, SEBI. And she has only one theme: how a common man is cheated by rich people. Endlessly. She tells you, yahan ye hua, wahan wo hua. Here you acted like an ass, here you were foolish, here you should have done this. And then she curses the government and she tells them you should behave this way. Amazingly public oriented writing by a professional expert, Sucheta Dalal. I have met her, an amazing woman. They conduct now financial literacy workshops free in different cities, and if you get a chance, go there. And she shows you common folks are such idiots that you give your money to thieves, okay, and then complain and cry. So first become wiser. So her lecture topic is safe way of managing your money, etc., things like that. Very, very interesting person. It is on her website that Sandeep Khurana writes some very exciting articles, and these articles about Hindi movies. Now what is the connection? So Khurana says, public, you are being cheated by the producers of Hindi movies. Second statement, public, you are being cheated by the reviewers of Hindi movies. So those are the 2 points we will now work on. How producers cheat us and how reviewers cheat us. Now what do you mean cheat us? Nobody cheats me because I don't go to any Hindi movies. I watch a movie when it is free on TV. So nobody can cheat me. That's right. But what they mean is those who are gullible and idiots, they tell them अभी बहुत great film आने वाला है, बाकी काम छोड़ो, तुम्हारी लड़की का शादी है वो भी postpone करो, पहले हमारा movie देखो. Secondly, you see it when the tickets are at the highest rate, 150, 250 rupees. People who will otherwise refuse to give a small donation to their school will readily pay 250 rupees for a stupid Hindi movie. So that is they persuade you to buy a ticket when in fact that movie is absolutely worthless. Then you will ask, how the devil do you know the movie is worthless? You say, that's not my judgment, that's your judgment. How? We'll see. So he says, in the first half of 2012, 35 Hindi movies were released. Sabki dekhne ka hai. Not my favorite only. 33 reported weekly collections at the box office. And those data are available on public website. So that's what he has used. He has no secret insider's information. And he says, see, the economics of movies has changed drastically in one generation. When I was a young man, there was this one Marathi earth-shaking movie. It was the Launi movie, which ran for 2 years in a Pune theater named Aryan. No, Sangte Aika. So, in those days, movies used to run for months and years. Now, movies run for 2 weeks. the life of a movie in India, Hindi movie, is 2 weeks. In the third week it runs, but it runs means it crawls. In fourth week it runs, then only theater owner is idiot. Nobody runs that movie in the fourth week, okay? So, most of the money is made in the first week. They open on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, that's the earning, okay? And then second week the earning goes down drastically. The difference between earnings of 2 weeks is Khurana's measure of quality of movie. So he has an objective measure. Now educationists can ask, you can have any kind of a measure, is it a valid, what are the words? There are two words they use, reliable and is it valid. So we will look into that. And then we have these goats to be massacred now. Taran Adarsh, Raju Masand, Anupama Chopra and Raja Sen. Out of these first, I only heard the name Anupama Chopra because when I am surfing on my TV channel, there is a channel where Anupama Chopra reviews the movies. But otherwise, other names I don't know. But he says these are the great reviewers of Hindi movies in India. So be it. All right, look at this. This is not a good transparency because I have simply copied the image, okay, but I can read something on my, what is on the y-axis, it is the loss or reduction in collection between 2 weeks, okay. The shortest bar is about 3%, the first shortest bar is about 3%, everything is negative, there is always reduction, rarely does the collection of second week exceed the collection of the first week. Everything is negative. Shortest one is 3%, and it is for the movie Vicky Donor. Anybody here has seen Vicky Donor? Okay, I have not. Is it a good movie? Okay. So if that difference is small, it is supposed to be a good movie. Next, the reduction is 20%, and the movie is Kahani. Anybody here seen Kahani? So then it is supposed to be a good movie. Okay. Now let us look at some bad movies. The last one, I think, is called Maximum, possible, or I am not reading it well. Or let me read another one, Department or something, what?
Yes, Department.
And Gully Gully Chor Hai. And Bloody Mary. These are all absolutely third-class movies because they all lost about 90%. So 100 rupees in the first week, 10 rupees in the second. So this is the criteria. These are very bad movies. So very simple quantitative measure, and you have a simple criterion for judging. Now statisticians should look at this graph. So aggregate week-wise collection post-release. Remember, we are not talking about calendar dates. First week after the release of the film. For each film, that week will be different. And if you total up the earning, then in the first week, total collection of all 33 movies in the first week after collection was 613 crore rupees. In second week, 200 crore rupees. In third week, 70 crore rupees. In fourth week, 23. So he says this is a rule of three. He says it's a geometric progression with a multiplier 1/3. 600 crore in the first week, 200 crore in the second week, 70 crore in the third week, 1/3 of 70 is 24 crore in the fourth week. Virtually pakka match, you know. So this is the pattern. The collection goes down exponentially. Another way of putting the same thing, 67% collection is in week 1, 22% collection purple in the week 2, 7-8% collection in week 3, and nothing in week 4 onwards. Okay, this is the economics of films, Hindi films at least, in India, at least in 2012. But he thinks that this is how things are by and large. Again, this is not very...